Good morning. My name is Carolyn Hosanna, and I'm a freshman in the African American Movements Program with Chico Herbison and Naima Lowe. I'm so excited to be here today to have the opportunity to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Alexis Pauline Gumbs. I began doing research into some of her work for a research project this quarter, and I became particularly interested in her work around Black feminism and just the empowerment of Black women. She is the founder and provost of External Summer, the Black Feminist Mind, Multiversity, and the co-creator of Mobile Homecoming. She is also the co-editor of Revolutionary Mothering, Love on the Front Lines, and the author of Spill. She earned her PhD in English, Africana Studies, and the Feminist Studies from Duke University in 2010. It's truly an honor to welcome such a published scholar here today. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Alexis Gumbs.
Chained in a nightmare Atlantic, little Phyllis survived, meter by meter, dreaming your face. 2022, poets who write sci-fi worlds with drinkable water, called reckless dreamers by thirsty critics. Octavia smiles and swims home. And everyone in this room wears something now that could easily have been ocean. Good morning. Thank you all so much for being here. I want to dedicate what I'm doing here today to my brother Seneca. Today is Seneca's 20th birthday. Happy birthday, Seneca. I talked to him on the phone. He was like, I know it's weird, right? How can I be 20? Like, it's very weird for me. But Seneca is a dreamer. Seneca is a visionary. Seneca is a video game designer and programmer. And Seneca is a sophomore at Vanderbilt University. So I'm dedicating what I do here today to him with love. And I want to invite you to dedicate what you do in here today to somebody who's not physically in this room. So if you could turn to somebody who's sitting near you and make a dedication, like dedicate your listening and your participation in this session to somebody who's not physically here, but who you want to send love to, now would be the time to do it. Take about 2 minutes. And when everyone's seated, we can start back up. Echolocation. I would sing you the shape of the world between us. Turn my body into drum to let you know. Slam my skin onto the surface of the ocean to tell you I am here wherever you are. If it's dream you listening for, I'll dream you. If it's poetry in the morning, whatever, the radio, just test me. There is nowhere I cannot be. There is no sound I cannot travel through. There is no you I don't surround. You can look or not look. You can fill your days with running or the shoes of other people. You can suffocate the minutes. I have time. I do not leave you. You can muffle every moment with your fear. It doesn't matter. I'm still here. And I am here. And I am here. Echolocation is what whales and dolphins do, the ones with teeth. They create a three-dimensional picture of the underwater world for themselves with sound refracted back to them. This is how they move through the depth. Collectively, pods of whales communicate with each other. They bounce sounds into harmony, creating layered descriptions of what is between them, the schools of fish, the nuances of movement. They coordinate their actions. This is how they live. This is how they know when to open their mouths and when to shut them. And opening your mouth and shutting it means timing is everything. We have so much to learn from the dolphins and whales. Groups of whales even communicate with other groups of whales many miles away, leaping out of the water and slamming back into it. The talking drum, trusting water to carry an intercommunal message. To me, it seems like magic, but it's not perfect. Just recently, on the coast of New Zealand, hundreds of whales found themselves beached on a sandbar. One scientist estimates 666. They made a miscalculation. The scientist explains, when you are networked, in communication with your species across space, a miscalculation can be costly. Hundreds of these whales were able to get back out to sea with the help of humans who needed the lesson. What happens when we seriously miscalculate what is between us? What great loss of life when we misunderstand? A great mass of our species, at least our land-based pod on this continent and beyond the contiguous United States, seems recently to have made a serious miscalculation. Something we tried to tell ourselves was impossible happened. The polls were wrong. And the world gasped in horror in November as this huge country beached itself. The floundering responses, the gasping for air, the major loss of life, impossible to ignore now. We have so much to learn from the whales if we listen. And this is what I think we need. Echolocation, to move through the depths, to know what's between us, to open and shut our mouths in appropriate ways. Because it's not just this past fall that we've been miscalculating what exactly is between us. It's been much longer, centuries of mammal forgetting that got us to this moment, and all the loss of life between us. But I think we could remember how to echolocate, how to communicate with our whole bodies, how to sound beyond the silos, the echo chambers of our comfort. When to open your mouth, when to close it. Do you know? So what I want to enact here, right now, together, is an echolocation re-memory oracle. And it requires your mammal attention. It requires your long-term breathing and your right now love. Are you with me? Okay, let's take a deep breath. Scientists are actually still debating about how whales make the sounds that they use to echolocate. Are there any marine biologists in here? Any oceanographic musicologists? I just made that up. That's just a thing. But if you're in here, if you're like, oh, that is me, create your own major. But the theory is that these sounds emerge from whale and dolphin foreheads. So touch your forehead. Let's take another deep breath. Okay. So this is how the echolocation rememory oracle works. I'm going to read one word at a time from the poem that I started with at the very beginning. And one of you, at least, will respond out loud with a word. Or else you will silently notice the word that comes to you, like a free association, if we were free. So that word is the oracle activator, our portal into multi-dimensional collective perception of our shared environment. So whether you say your word out loud or not, you may notice your word in relationship to the words you hear said in that moment, and I'll draw on those words as keywords to find a passage from my forthcoming book, M, Archive After the End of the World, a passage that's between those words, and I'll read it out to us. And then you can listen to that passage with your word in mind. This is complicated, but does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. And we'll learn something about what is between us, about listening and feedback, about opening and closing our mouths, and when and where it leaves us. Ready? Okay, here we go. 1761. The shortest way to say it is that they made themselves obsolete. The plushly educated learned to use the right words as cushions in their days. Soft, soft. They suffocated meaning under diction, meaning it didn't matter. It was fluff they were training to be. How quickly could you find a right-sounding thing to say became the determining factor in interviews and semester-closing pleas to increase unearned grades. It was a skill that would serve them well as they negotiated their irrelevance in the next place and the next. Deep down, they knew everything and kept it, protected it, which is why they were so nervous to be looked at. Try it. Look at them when they are silent. It's almost like it hurts to be so soft. Chained. It was the salt she wants us to know. It was the salt, final repository of the shore and salt of home. We were preserved and packaged flesh. We were reduced to our salt. Chemical archaeologists have run projections on the ships by now, accounting for the ocean, accounting for the wreck, accounting for the centuries of neglect, they estimate that the air in the hold was as many parts saline as oxygen. But you could have asked anyone sitting on the porch back in her day. There were spaces we made in our palate to preserve what preserved us, be it blood, water, waste, be it sweat, tears, or secretions, be it breathing or decomposition. What she knew was, if the body could gather enough salt, it could stay. It could stand anything. It could reconstitute the stolen soil in vain. Taste is not a big enough word to hold it, what we went through. Nightmare. They found them, the dream rooms and the body doubles, and it made sense. Rooms filled with sounds of water, crackling heat rooms, rooms with dirt walls and wide rooms like the widest air shaft you ever saw. They had thought themselves the owners of their bodies, their minds sovereign in a specific space and time. There was a break in the line when they discovered they were less and more at once. Imagine touching your hand to your hand and knowing that you and the whole world that you can perceive are the projection of a dream machine made out of the sleeping minds of people whose bodies look just like yours. What happens when they wake up, you have to think. What and when am I, really, you must wonder. How did their dreams make rooms to dream in? Whence their peaceful bodies? Whence their instantly activating minds? But more than that, the investigative scientist asked the self that might have been listening, looking at the slightly moving eyelashes of her beautiful double, and what if she changes her dream? Atlantic. And then there were the dirt-colored hands that had never held money. Field hands, marked hands of exchange and grow and wait and scrub and sometimes room and board or hot strained liquor. Those hands that wanted to do and make scratched with histories of refusal. There was worldwide confusion as to who exactly had been cursed when their ancestors had made the sacrifice in blood and fire never more to be slaves. And the brown eyes that had never held paper or coins with watermarks of chains, the deep brown eyes that had never shallowed to currency, the nuanced artists without the luxury or the lash of abstraction, the washing well women who refused, who refined reuse into ritual. At the end, they already knew how to be brown and thirsty and free. Little. It got to the point where she could close her eyes and map the universe. Stars dying, voids reversing, oceans freezing on planets far away. She could find it all somewhere inside. Sounds beautiful, but it was inconvenient. Why should she wake up in the middle of the night just because a volcano erupted on a planet orbiting another star? Why should she cry in the middle of a conversation just because the poles of some poor planet were melting into oceans? She began to hate the word middle. And the fake scientists, who of course had never understood dark matter, had colonized space in their imaginations. And it was all too easy for them to confine her to infinite tests, to place electric nodes on her smallest muscles, to link her breathing to 12 different computer monitors in 12 different offices. Sometimes, despite all the noise, she would fall asleep and know that Sartji was holding her hand. Meanwhile, the real scientists, marooned to their asylums, overpasses, and parks, knew something was off. The trackers were not quite quantum in their calculations, not quite witnessing because of the way they had been trained. The real scientists spoke about it, and nobody listened, but they kept talking, knowing the real recording would rewind eventually. The universe always knows when she is being disrespected. She is patient, but she is not the patient. And so lightning struck where it had to, and all the monitors linked to dark flesh went dark, and homegirl just quietly walked away, content never to be in the middle of everything, committed to always be in the middle of everything. Phyllis. Eventually, they all remembered they were their own great, 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 great grandmothers. And they started to think of their grandmothers and mothers as more than the reason for all their neuroses and aggravating needs. They began to acknowledge their foremothers as the daughters they had always wanted to have. They started being, just being, the mothers they had always wanted to be. They remembered the selves they had sent across generations and realized it wasn't time that would make the difference, nor the specific mass of land. It was the act of choosing each other again. Survived. That was the challenge, to create oneself anew on a regular basis. It started with every 7 years, also called the new cell cycle, and accelerated for the talented to every 3 years, every year, every season, every month, every day, until the prestige came from recreating a self unrecognizable to both your former self and the expectations of others multiple times in any given day. They said it was towards the evolution of the community. A community that could not depend on previous expectations would have to evolve new needs. Their individual shape-shifting was towards less collective dependence on a former world. Let the new world meet us faster where we are, the people sometimes said to affirm a particularly brave reinvention. They went from mostly not knowing their neighbors to perpetually not knowing themselves, which seemed more useful. And like the rare urban neighbor with the time to watch their transforming neighbors walk in and out their doors differently every day, the social media applications were even more useful for creating narrative out of the random moments of self-documentation offered by the digitally literate. Maybe that's where they went wrong, the watching. Because at some point, the point changed from transforming need and evolving skills to performing further and further newness, as if novelty itself was the measure and the outcome and the point again. And eventually, it distilled down to the same people looking different every day and going to the same places they always went just to provoke contrast and doing the same things they always did, eventually just the work of looking for and financing new costumes. So the challenge was called off around the time when it got most boring. It wasn't worth the use of fossil fuels. Meter by meter. She built it out of scraps she found on the road. The rubber of blown out tires, the dented metal memories of how fast everything used to move. Almost as if it had all wanted to rush to the end, wanted to break. She thought of caddisflies as she added piece to piece, welded by her intention, the heat and the pressure of the space between stones where she worked, marooned to the task of trying to put things back together in a different relationship than they had ever had before, the task of believing there was some possible relation that wouldn't mean detonation. The point was that there was light enough for her to move and heavy enough to hold her down when the winds came. The purpose was that the light could come through, but no one could see her in the dark. The major saving grace was that no one was looking for something like this in the form she had formed out of brokenness. It was lack of recognition, once again, that allowed her to create this small world. Dreaming. We broke the earth, and now we fall through time. Deep gashes in the ground, we scale the edges of our knowing. The smoother, the worse, the more jagged, the more better. What we stand on is not masonry. It is the torn places unhealed. The footholds come from how unclean the break. We broke the earth, and now we fall through time, because marching on a line we thought was forward only called up the urgency of the abyss, who said with her dilating presence, "You cannot live like this, breathe the air here." And so we witness layers. The ground time had buried over, awakened like the amber of escape, the fossilized texts we needed, landfilled manuscripts freeze-dried by the returning ice. We fell into the archive of our failure. And this is what we found. Your face. There was the face she made when she pretended to be listening. There was the face she made out of paper mache. There was the face she drew on with pencils and painted with brushes to keep the compliments coming and the questions away. There was the expectant 3-year-old face she avoided. There was the fountain face she anointed unceasingly with tears. There was the face made from pushing her mouth closed and biting her tongue. There was the face bruised from falling down the ladder and hitting every rung. There was the face that looked too much like her father and too much like her mother and too much like her fear. There were the faces that went in and out of fashion every year. There was the face that faced itself and screamed and screamed. There was the face she thought was hers when she saw it in her dreams. There was the face she felt for each morning when she rose. There was that exact same face, but with a much longer nose. Each face had its own neck, its own long flexibility for avoiding sun, hydra huge and hiding, and there was the sword in her hand. 2022. Truth be told, she couldn't wait to get out from the surface, down past the sulfuric decimated air. The layer that protected the surface had been poisoned. Now the only refuge was dirt. But not everyone could accept that. She learned slowly that the surface dwellers thought of themselves as clean, narrated their limited breathing capacity as refinements whenever they had enough energy to talk. She always imagined brittle landscapes in their lungs, yellow as the ground they crawled, and sharp. monuments to desperation that stacked and broke off with their breathing. How else could you explain the rattling sound? Her elders were specific. Only a certain amount of hours above ground. Only a certain set of rehearsed answers about where she was from, who she was, and she should only use her full strength in an emergency. Even this, they reminded her, urgently, as if she could ever forget, was a major but necessary risk. In another version of the story, she would have snuck extra time above ground. She would have grown addicted to open space and range of motion. She would have believed the lies the surface people told themselves and emulated them. Or she would have pitied them so much, she'd have tried to save them from themselves. Maybe she would fall in love with someone her own age and realize that they weren't so different after all, and environment wasn't everything. Or do like the colonizers did and let pheromones override the visual enough. None of those things happened. She counted her seconds like she was taught. She debated whether to tell anyone that above ground was worse than they had described, worse than anyone had imagined. But she didn't want to seem like she was begging off the mission. It was only temporary, the elders promised. Only a few more times. Every time, she couldn't wait to get back underground. Poets. At first, nobody signed up for the courses. Some knowing it would add them to surveillance lists, make it harder to fly, insert clicks into their phone conversations, make their windows more than windows. And some didn't need to know that, already having told themselves that freedom wasn't allowed specifically so they wouldn't have to ponder the consequences. But eventually, they showed up with the only permitted writing utensil, the crayon, melting in their hands. Soon enough, they realized they would have to memorize everything, internalize all of it, keep it in their bodies. Soon enough, there would be nowhere else to keep anything anyway. And the people watching eventually saw the patterns. They knew to watch for singing and the radiance vibrating off the skin of the student teachers. Many felt so attracted that they begged to go into deep cover to infiltrate the courses, and each and every one was welcomed and converted. Freedom is not a secret. It's a practice. It's contagious. The would-be infiltrators could not get the songs out of their skin. They could not resell out the places where they had internalized freedom. They could not undo the implications of the rituals they thought they were sneaking into. And that's how, one at a time, the watchers became the watched. The new attractors of their bewildered colleagues, pushed seemingly by their desire to crack the core, but actually, it was their desire to access freedom. People called it a cult and a misguided fad. They referred to it as the new yoga. Stand-up comedians compared the sessions to key parties with swingers. Even radicals dismissed it as just as hopeful and insufficient as 1970s feminist consciousness-raising groups. Religious leaders just thought they were Baha'i. But eventually, the curriculum was everywhere, transmitted between roommates and on buses with the tenderness of love. There were children showing up qualified to teach all the advanced courses. They needed bigger and bigger spaces, so they started to meet outside. And then they didn't need classrooms at all because the practices were jumping off everywhere. Not without effort, but without force. All day, through their eating and conversation, sometimes they stopped and marveled about how thoroughly they had replaced the story that was there before. But usually, They just stayed in the practice and watched the world transform. Right. The prison tattoo artists were ahead of the game. They knew, without anyone having to spell it out, that the body was the home that mattered, that matter was the muscle of home, no matter that this too, this very flesh, could be repossessed. Well, it did matter. And how much more important than the inked science of permanence, the reverence for becoming gods with the most beautiful talent for rebirth marks. So the people spelled out their names, the names of their crews, the names of their dead. They sketched the remembered symbols that fell out of their knocked around heads. They drew out the lines in the faces they would never see again. They built room on their skin. And when even their skin was stolen, they remembered the maps and went within. Sci-fi. This thing about one body. It was the Black feminist metaphysicians who first said it wouldn't be enough, never had been enough, was not the actual scale of breathing. They were the controversial priestesses who came out and said it in a way that people could understand, which is the same as saying they were the ones who said it in a way that the foolish would ignore and then complain about and then co-opt without ever mentioning the Black feminist metaphysicians again, like with intersectionality. But that's another apocalypse. The Lord of their understanding had taught them, this work began before I was born and it will continue. The university taught them, through its selective genocide, one body, the unitary body, one body was not a sustainable unit for the project at hand. The project itself being Black feminist metaphysics, which is to say, breathing. Hindsight is everything, and also one of the key reasons that the individual body is not a workable unit of impact. But if the biochemists had diverted their energy towards this type of theoretical antioxidant around the time of the explicit emergence of this idea, let's say the end of the second to last century, everything could have been different. If the environmentalists sampling the ozone had factored this in, the possibilities would have expanded exponentially. That wouldn't have happened. And of course, we see that it didn't, because of the primary incompatibility, the constitutive element of individualism being adverse, if not antithetical, to the dark feminine, which is to say, everything. To put it in tweetable terms, they believed they had to hate Black women in order to be themselves. Even many of the Black women believed it sometimes, which is also to say that some of the people on the planet believed they themselves were actually other than Black women, which was a false and impossible belief about origin. They were all, in their origin, maintenance, and measure of survival, more parts Black women than anything else. It was like saying they were no parts water, which they must have believed as well, since you see what they did to the water. The problematic core construct was that in order to be sane, which is to live in one body at one time, which is to disconnect from the Black simultaneity of the universe, the problematic core construct was that that was a valid form of breathing, and more importantly, the only form, the fundamental fallacy being obvious now, obscured at the time, that there is no separation from the Black simultaneity of the universe, also known as everything, also known as the Black feminist pragmatic intergenerational sphere. Everything is everything, and it always has been. They thought escaping the dark feminine was the only way to earn breathing room in this life. And they were wrong. You can have breathing and the reality of the radical Black porousness of love, aka Black feminist metaphysics, aka all of us, or you cannot. There is only both or neither. There is no either or. There is no this or that. There is only both and all. This was their downfall. They hated the Black women who were themselves, a suicidal form of genocide. So that was it. They could only make the planet unbreathable. Worlds. Remember the frogs. After everything we had tried to say to prove that human was human beyond gender, after people had cobbled together the bodies of loved ones out of rubble that didn't segregate or care, after the water content and the advocacy advance led to historically unprecedented numbers of proud intersex leaders, after the pronoun transformation and the protests and the institution building and the ostensibly safer spaces, we let that go and took a different approach. We like to think of it as an evolutionary approach. And really, at that point, what could anyone do with this rising water but emulate the amphibians? What we had done to the planet made us crave and need a bothness of slick skin and webbing and genital adaptability. They say that it was deep in the ocean that certain fish learned to self-fertilize, or that after the Ice Age, the remaining amphibians evolved how they needed to, and if any species knew how to decimate habitat, I mean how to zone ourselves out of safe spaces for contact, it was ours, right? Or what we had been. And our range of ancestors moved beyond the eunuchs to a more ancient and just as relevant set of references. Some said it would be the extremely logical endpoint of our individualism and ownership, self-impregnation. But we, the evolutionaries, knew it was just as valuable as transparent waterproof skin over your eyeballs. We could become whomever we needed to be for each other. We created the future in form. Drinkable. It was no longer a matter of sex. This new molecular relationship made distance and intimacy words that tangled. Or to say it another way, we were all close, beyond close. Not knowing where one person ended and another began was no longer love song advertising or evidence of codependency. It was a real issue. So then, identity, X equals X, was no longer technically true. The previous energetic reality of how we are not whole and change each other and are not ourselves except in the most limited version of our imagination became impossible to ignore on the physical level. So love was not about merging or finding exceptional moments when we could die enough to shrug off the pain of individuality. It was just a certain sound, a vibration, and when we achieved it, it was really all of us. Water. Oh. Okay. Their small bones could have regrown from this. Marrow being eager like it is, God paying attention like she should have been. We make our children into starfish. Trust that they will reproduce their amputated smiles no matter what we show them, no matter what we show ourselves by risking them like this. Their small bones ultimately indistinguishable from plaster. We traded their lives to build these buildings, heated and cooled them as if they wouldn't need to breathe air, plumbed and drained them as if they wouldn't need water. We built these cities with the advance of their bones, which we knew would crumble under the weight of this. This is what we do. This is what we daily do. We violate the trust of being born. Reckless. Remember when they did all those movies about zombies, but they didn't include an Afro-Caribbean cosmology of death and servitude, and the people watched it nightly or alone or together with their slick popcorn or pretending to be together through interconnected video games with surround sound machine gun noises? When it happened, it was not like that at all. And not only because there was still no white savior. After it happened, it was hard to remember how we had walked on this land and breathed this air before without the thickness of knowing. They had always been here. Every indigenous community massacred, every single prophet assassinated, every child sacrificed to colonialism, every slave rebel shackled in their grave, every unassigned body piled as refuse somewhere had never disappeared. Whatever part they burned into air, whatever part they buried underground, whatever part they threw in the sea came whole again in every breathing, growing thing. And when the warning time came, they were, all of them, screaming. Dreamers. They began to study the death of the black artist, strung out the veins on tables to dissect them, looking for the impact of ink, early mornings and that repeated refusal to be silent. They wanted to know if there was physiological weight to the common perception that their ancestor portals were enlarged. And if so, what swelling, what inflammation bore the evidence of that transit? Did it crowd the other organs out, for example? Cause the liver to work harder or less? What was in them that made work more food to them than food was? And tobacco? Was it indigenous memory? How often did they paint their insides with substance and strain? Is there an imprint that deepens in the face of repeated misunderstanding and tokenization? Does it inoculate the blood? What they found gave them pause. But they published a cursory article on Ego and the Black Artist to comply with the funding. And most of them moved on to other things and didn't tell each other that they never slept through the night again. It wasn't until your girl Nanine, the great scientist, came back through and looked through the records that she shook her head and drew up the next phase, prototype for eternal life serum, phase indigo. Thirsty. This time, she put her face directly in the dirt. No glasses to remove, no precious hair to pull back, no back to brace her to look up at the sky. Just dirt, hard enough and soft enough to hold her. Part of the day, she pounded the earth with her fists and screamed blame and despair. Part of the day, she let soil slip through her fingers and felt comforted. Most of the day, she just acclimated herself to solid breathing and seeing all there was, which was brown. Critics. This is how you prepare for a haunted planet. On the scale of the galaxy, they will call it a ghost town. You go to the city of the dancing funerals and the decorated graves, and you listen. You walk around in the populated air and thicken your knowing. You breathe the backlocked water of the Left for Dead and smile a painted smile. Some people will tell you it's about sea level, but the sea doesn't have to level with you. It rises, runs at you, floods your footing, so those people are right, the bones of the drowned remain. Some people will tell you it's the exotic influence of the French, to which I say, yes, something like that. It's that breathing funk surrounding every word, it's the throat forever trying not to gag. Some people will tell you it's an Afro-Indigenous holding pattern, a pact that says, as long as you don't get it, we will stay here, hanging, moss-like, in the lingering trees. Octavia. It got that the glow was so great, they could only sneak up after dark. And even then it might cause a total disruption. Day instigation, the calling out of the remaining rooster descendants, the beginning of the surface work cycle off cue. The risk was a high noon from the depths of each. They had to hope that if they emerged and were spotted, they would be dismissed as flashback to UFO abduction syndrome by the rural transcendence, which is to say, the bold banked on their impossibility in order to move unseen, bright as they were. It was not recommended to emerge. But that's not what matters. That's really not what matters. What I'm trying to get at is how bright the inner light can get when it needs to in a situation of necessary darkness and total immersion in the material, which is to say, underground or at the bottom of the sea. And we cultivated it over generations. You need to understand that if you are going to put these in order. There was a time when inner light was a metaphor for something else. That might have been us. But this was not then. Swims. It started as an old April Fool's joke that none of us are old enough to have witnessed. There was a kingdom called Google. Kingdom Google bought the planet by managing the information and helping no one have to remember anything anymore. And the empire called Google managed most of the information that people sent digitally to each other through machines. Are you following me? Yes, it was like telepathy, but at that point, they needed these machines to access their own telepathy. That's what a sad state, meaning planetary moment, it was. Anyway, the vast majority of the communication was digital before it became telepathic. The major change our ancestors experienced was the change from paper to digital, which was as unimaginable and overwhelming to them in their time as the move to psycho-spiritual interpersonal storage is to us at our time. But nonetheless, it was totally dominant. Almost every human on the planet had or wanted access to a digital device. It was how they externalized their thinking. So what was the joke? I'm getting to it. One day, on April Fool's, it's a fertility day they celebrated because they knew, without saying it, that laughter and humiliation led to more heterosexual shame sex. One day, on April Fool's, the empire called Google decided to pretend that they were starting a new service called Paper, where they would materialize the digital communications flying through their zone of influence, which was planetary and total as far as they knew, and send them through the postal service, the previous rulers of the empire of information. It functioned very well as a joke, and it both reminded the subjects how much they loved the speed and lightness of digital communication and provided a kick in the teeth to the actual postal service, which for some reason still existed, but was at that time going bankrupt. You don't know the historical context, so the joke isn't funny, but the joke is not the point. I'm telling you the story of the baskets, not the story of the joke. The joke was just the accidental spark. Late capitalism, the whole thing was a bad, clever joke with a cruel duration. And we have reclaimed our laughter for better, more beautiful purposes by now, I hope. I need you to know that the empire called Google and its other digital allies would never have actually done this paper thing they were joking about doing. It was a joke, not a threat. Though the joke of capitalism threatened everything that it did not outright destroy. The digital empire depended on the interconnective intuition we already had, but the development of intuition was also a threat. What could make digital products obsolete faster than a telepathic market? In fact, they were engaging all of their workers in the practice of imagining more and more ways to make their own digital services less and less intuitive. By training people out of intuition and into internalized dependence on digitally externalized invisible connection, they sought to make their influence indispensable and eternal. We know how that went. But anyway, one of our ancestors, who it turns out was also a descendant of the legendary stagecoach Mary, was inspired by the joke. She saw it as a threat in a way that was exactly opposite of the intention of the joke and the general response to it. Most people laughed and forgot about it by April 2nd. This person, let's call her Mary, felt called and compelled to make the joke real. It was the only way to unyoke the joke. What if, she said, every digital communication flying through wireless wires were to have a material counterpart receivable through the obsolete mail service or hand-to-hand through the redistribution of found objects? Mary especially loved to use popsicle sticks, maybe because of their saliva residual. And yes, she really talked like that. On pieces of used paper, discarded clothes, trash of all kinds, Mary started making a tangible and dirty archive of the clean digital world. Well, Google had zillions, and Mary was only Mary, so she had to get help. She had to induct people into her practice, but it was actually not that hard. There were many people who craved a return to paper, but who had been ashamed to admit it in front of the few remaining trees. Mary's reminder that the most abundant resource of the Google generation was still trash, often in the forms of boxes shipped by the almighty ally, Amazon, changed everything. And they got on board and they brought down the messages from the cloud into the crowd in rather disruptive and beautiful ways, I must say. Some of the most talented hackers joined Mary, and so even government secrets and encrypted lab experiments were floating around on sweetly placed candy wrappers and the like. And so that is how the tradition was born that ultimately led to this thing we are doing now. That is how the story of the apocalypse ultimately got in our hands. Okay, that's lesson one. Home. And then there was the melanin. Long after the artists learned to full body tattoo their skin every color of the rainbow, the melanin started to matter more again. It was as if the sun had moved closer, but really we had simply burned up everything between us and that nearest star. And when, at a major loss to vulnerable test subjects, they discovered that melanin itself could not be extracted, and retain its sun protective powers, Africa began the last era of its resource-rich life. What was a rich, dark continent without the unity and utility of extraction? The World Bank economists gave up trying to predict what it meant. And when light-skinned women started to have trouble finding darker-skinned partners, the seasoned advertisers in the magazines had to retire. What did paleness mean as a physical liability with no discourse strong enough to elevate it? Even Dominicans started putting dirt on their faces. This is how the story that we had used to justify the full-scale destruction of the world outgrew itself at last. But was it too late? Okay, the end. Thank you for your participation. I'm going to pull that chair over and sit here, and please ask any question that you have at this time.
What a great question.
That's a very specific question. Yes, I see the mind and body as connected. I see everything as connected, which you may have noted. I think that I'm interested in how scientists like really don't know that much about whales, and I am proud of the whales for that. Like, not to say that I avoid scientists in my daily life, just to say that they avoid scientists, like they avoid us, and they're like, we're doing something deeper, and you don't know. You don't know how we process all this salt and stay hydrated. You don't know how we make these sounds that allow us to know everything. So I'm interested in the fact that there's something going on with whales, so then they're like projecting these sounds and they're describing that to each other. Is that a mind? What is its relationship to body? You know, like, what is that relationship to body and communication? I like that it's a mystery. It's still a mystery to me, at least. There may be somebody who knows. Maybe an oceanographic musicologist knows. And if you find one, please email me at alexispauline@gmail.com. But yeah, so the way that it affects my what? My interpersonal... My intrapersonal, within myself, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think I find it really useful, the way that my understanding that mind and body are connected affects my intrapersonal dialogue and perception of self is that there's still mystery. You know, like I think I know myself, and my work as an artist is to continue to realize again that I don't know. And so that there's a possibility for rebirth in that. That's how I relate to it. What a profound and beautiful question. I know I didn't repeat the whole thing, but
thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Anybody else have a question that I'll try my best to repeat? Yeah. What a great question. So the question was, what's my process in relationship to my art, and does it have a connection to how I'm able to use it in a way that it incorporates response? That's a paraphrasing of your question, which you said even more elegantly. But I would say that, so this work is called M, Archive After the End of the World, and it has been generated by a process that has multiple references, but that is deeply engaged with the work of a scholar in particular, whose name you should write down. Her name is M. Jackie Alexander. And she is the author of a book called Pedagogies of Crossing, which is the major, major reference for every single page of this manuscript. And so, similarly to my book Spill, which some Evergreen students are reading, and which is I hear available in the bookstore, and there is one copy of it in the air. It's a similar process that I engage. So in that work, I was engaging another theorist who's important to me, Hortense Spillers, and phrases from her work I used as prompts every single morning, and I woke up directed by that prompt. In Pedagogies of Crossing, M. Jackie Alexander has a lot of questions. I was interested in her questions as prompts, not to answer them, but to prompt me. And then I was interested in other phrases that she has that just were mysterious to me as part of that access to a mystery that I was talking about. And so my process was similar to our process in here, in that, okay, I'm using this short piece, and then I'm free associating except towards freedom. And so when I share it with you in here, I wanted it to be part of a form of intimacy with the process. You know, also the vulnerability of being like, I don't even know what pages of the manuscript I'm going to share with them. I know conceptually I want to talk about echolocation, but what would it mean for us to do echolocation? I don't know what word associations you all would make with these words from that first poem that we started with. And then how would that prompt me to look differently even at my own work? Or to be like, oh, wow, well, there's this passage. Oh, well, someone said these words. And basically what I was just doing was like using the find feature in Microsoft Word and like typing the words that you said in and being like, oh, I never used that word ever in this manuscript. Or, or oh, this word is in this particular passage, and so this is what I'm sharing back, right, to become a part of our process again. And I think that's important for me. It's informed by generations of improvisatory practice. I think about that as part of a legacy of Black spiritual practice. I also think about it as a legacy of jazz, which really informs my work. So if I'm really in right relationship with my work, I should be able to be responsive with it with you, right? I should be able to live in here with you. And if I actually don't have that relationship with that work yet, then I shouldn't share from that work yet. But it worked, so so thank you. It was definitely an experiment. Thanks for that question. Does somebody have another question? Oh, what a great question. Yes, I do make the collages. I made this collage. And the question was, so on my website, there is After Brightest Star series, which is a series of poems that are prompted by Octavia Butler's Earth Seed verses from her books Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents. And I wrote these poems prompted by those verses, but also in conversation with a process, a community process I was involved in, of a people of color land collective called Earth Seed. So the poems are lessons that I learned in that process, but they're prompted by these specific verses, Earth Seed verses from a religion that an Octavia Butler character creates in the novel, the series of novels, Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents. So yes, I did make the collages, and I made those collages in conversation with that poetic work, and there's six of them. And then I used different details of the collages as a background in videos that I made of myself reading these poems and then asking questions about what other people are learning, especially what other people of color are learning in their practices of creating collectives and their relationships to land. So feel free to check that out and let me know, because there are prompts and you can comment and answer the questions for yourselves. But yeah, that's just part of my process of working through. And this one, I felt like for this work, this, first of all, the words After Brightest Star and kind of the apocalyptic nature of this work, but also those jellyfish and the word you felt like part of what I wanted you all to have in the room as we were engaging this process. So the question was about references to secrets and mysteries. How do I talk about that in relationship to this practice and its relationship to a jazz aesthetic? And, well, you said more words, but that's, if I got it, I hope I got it. and so, yes, it's really, and that's why I'm interested in whales as these mammals who navigate depth, and they have created and use a technology for navigating that space together, not being able to see, even though they're mammals who can see sometimes. But what about that depth? And so in this project, the dark scientists, the idea of darkness itself, and the issues that I see people within my species having with darkness, or the unknown, or the unknowable, or the mystery, is part of what I wanted to think about. You're like, what if that was what, like, what if enlightenment, or like shedding light on something, wasn't at the center of our practices of inquiry or investigation, our practices of learning? What if a deeper, deeper darkness was actually what people were going for? Like, what if we wanted to know the things that we study, all of us in here being people that study and investigators of something, what if we wanted it to become more and more unfamiliar to us? What if our goal was to know it less and less in a way that could make something else possible? And I say that as a Black artist, and when I say Black, that's part of what I mean when I say Black. I mean that I'm interested in the unknowable. I mean that if I'm afraid of the dark, I have something to learn from that fear. And that's where my work as an artist comes from. So Audre Lorde has a poem called Black Studies. It's one of my favorite poems. Write that down. Black Studies by Audre Lorde. Black Studies, one word. And working with that poem, so first of all, Audre Lorde, Black feminist, lesbian, warrior, mother poet, was one of the people who created Black Studies within the Academy. She was one of many people who helped create what that looked like in terms of curriculum. But she has this poem, and really what's Black about it, I would say, as an interpreter, is the confrontation with death, the confrontation across time, like the real encounter with her students, where they're gonna ask her to give them everything that she knows and everything that she has access to, but she's still not gonna know what they're gonna use those tools for. That's what's Black about it, or that's my interpretation of one of the things that's Black about it. It's not just that it centers Black people or African descendant practices diasporically, though it's no coincidence that it does, but that there's something about really reckoning with that there are things that we can't ever really know, and that's a good thing for us as a species. That is part of what I think Black studies, Black art is, or what I mean when I say I'm a queer Black troublemaker, Black feminist love evangelist, and why I say Black so much, and why Black is one of my favorite words. So it does have to do with that mystery. It does have to do with that secret. And also the possibility of liberation if we didn't have the relationship to darkness or depth or those parts of ourselves that we don't know or those parts of the other people around us that we don't know and can't access, of trying to penetrate and dominate because we're afraid of what we can't know about the people around us and we're terrified of what we don't know about ourselves. Yeah, great question. So I think we have time for one more question. Yes. Oh, thank you. That's a good question, because I don't really know. I just know, like, that was an aesthetic choice. So Spill is, and that's not necessarily the case with this manuscript, although capitalization, I'm using it in a different way because there is capitalization of proper nouns in Spill. Like VapoRub is capitalized, for example. It's a proper noun, and it's in the style guide for my book. They were like, this is how you capitalize VapoRub. I was like, oh, okay. Because that's it. TM, VapoRub, Xerox, things like that. But I'm not using capitalization at the beginning of sentences. I'm not using question marks at the end of all questions, but some questions, but not all questions have a question mark, I believe. And I'm not using capitalization of the word I in a consistent way. So I do capitalize it sometimes, and I don't capitalize it other times, and that's on purpose. So part of what that's about for me, and there are lots of ways that people have done that, and Bell Hooks has some really great things to say about not using capitalization that I would say check that out. But for me, it's rounder. For me, it's just generally rounder the less I capitalize. And there's something about the relationship between sentences that as a poet making prose blocks, which is what I do in Spill, I want there to be less barrier between the sentences, even when I put a period. Like there's less of a fence for the sentences to get over, to get to each other, is part of what I was thinking about. And then I also felt like it made less of a barrier between me and the words, and I was hoping that for the reader there would be a less barrier to those words, because there are scenes, but what I don't do in Spill is like really develop out characters that you then follow through a plot. I was interested in like troubling those narrative ideas, even though what inspired me to create Spill is the archive of all the literature written by Black women that I've ever read. But I wanted people to be able to look at that block of text, which is a scene from somebody's life, and not quite be able to say, this is someone else, this is not me. Maybe not completely be able to say, well, this is me, but to trouble the, like, this is a story about someone else. And for some reason, not capitalizing the letters at the beginning of sentences, and not capitalizing I, except for when I capitalize I, was part of why I did that. That's a great question. Nobody has asked me that. Not even the copy editor asked me that. So, thank you. Oh my goodness. So we have 2 minutes left. So if somebody has like a question they really, really want to ask, now would be the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The question was about repetition, and in the book Spill, how I use repetition, what inspired me to use it that way, and that there's an idea that there's the same message being presented, but in different ways, or maybe from different perspectives. So, yes. So, as a poet, I feel like repetition is so powerful, and I think about repetition in terms of how it works with ceremony, like people do the same thing over and over again. That's how rituals are created across time. Scientists do that. They repeat the order in which they do things, right? So they're creating ritual across time in labs right now. And repetition has this major function, but it also can be a signal, like pay attention to this, right, within a text. So for me, whereas if I wrote, you know, there are poetic forms that use repetition, or you could write a pantoum and you have repetition in certain moments. I'm a poet working through in Spill a book-length series of scenes that are blocks of prose text that don't look like poems, right? But the whole book is a poem, as far as I'm concerned. So the repetition that occurs there is the way that it can be a poem, but it's also it also has something to say about the persistence and repetition of the systems that people face that make Black feminist fugitivity necessary. And it has something to say about the repeated effort that we make, like the everydayness, that like every day, trying to get free, it is repetitive. And then I'm very interested like in the heartbeat itself. I'm interested in my heartbeat. I'm interested in the rhythm in that book, which is why I love to read it out loud to people, even though I didn't read any part of it out loud to you today. And I do think that repetition and rhyme are our time travel technologies. How is it that we face the same moment again, but it's different, but it's the same moment again, but it's different? But it's the same moment again, but it's different. There, I used repetition again. So I love that question too. Thank you all so much for being here. Excited to meet you. Come talk to me.